So the next talk will be given by Eric Rubin. Thank you for being with us from the States. I know that this is okay for you because you have only 6 hours difference. So thank you for coming from Harvard University. And you gave as a title Proteolysis in Pathogens, but I guess we will hear about mycobacteria probably. Thank you, Eric.
Thank you, Pascal. Thank you for asking me to this very interesting meeting, not every minute of which I've heard, because I wasn't up at 2:30, but I was up at 4:30. So I heard, got to hear a lot of it. Thanks to all the other speakers. I just want to give my acknowledge the people who worked on it. This is a modern lab meeting, actually, together with some people from Sarah Fortune's lab. This work was initiated by Tados, Olga, and Ravi, together with Fred Goldberg at Harvard. And more recently, we've been working with Nader and his team at the TB Alliance and Scott at the University of Illinois, along with a graduate student, Harry, and a postdoc, Jun Hao. When you asked me to talk about this, I was trying to think of what the comparisons we could make between mycobacteria and coronaviruses really were. They're both really small, but mycobacteria, which are E. coli sized, are much larger than coronaviruses, which are down around HIV sized there. So not exactly comparable. They're both spread through the air. We just heard that from Elena. And they both cause pneumonia, though the pneumonias are pretty distinct looking. And unfortunately, they both kill a lot of people. This is today's number from Johns Hopkins here on the right. Here, and then this is the yearly death rate from TB, which is still running up over a million deaths a year. They're both certainly bad pathogens. But I want to concentrate on something else, which is their therapy. So TB has actually a pretty good therapy, but it's only pretty good, of course, because there are still more than a million deaths a year. And for various reasons, our drugs are far from perfect for treating this disease. So we've got a long way to go. And this is a clinical study of remdesivir, which is the only published study so far with a successful conclusion. And it ain't a home run. I mean, it has some effect. I'm glad we have something that's effective, but it's not very impressive and we could do better. So that's why I'm going to focus on proteases today. Proteases play a lot of roles in pathogens. They can be direct acting factors, as in the case of botulinum toxin, which cleaves snares at the neuromuscular junction. They can help with spreading through tissue, as with these clostridial enzymes, which are also used therapeutically to break down tissue. And they certainly are activators of proenzymes. And this is something that we worked on for many years, an enzyme that needs to be cleaved in order for cell walls to form normally in mycobacteria. But today I'm going to focus on protein turnover. We know a fair amount about protein turnover from eukaryotes. In eukaryotes, one of the major factors for turning over proteins is the proteasome. The proteasome is this big structure here, which is this barrel-shaped structure, and it recognizes proteins by a few different ways, but the way that most people have studied is through the addition of ubiquitin moieties by ubiquitination. Mycobacteria also have a proteasome. It resembles the eukaryotic proteasome, another barrel-shaped structure. Mycobacteria don't have ubiquitin. Instead, they have this peptide called PUP, which can get added to proteins, which allows them to be degraded. And this is a relatively unusual system in bacteria. However, all bacteria have something called CLIP, which superficially resembles the proteasome. It's another barrel-shaped protease. It consists of actually two parts. One part is the protease itself. The protease is made up of two seven-membered rings, of identical subunits, each of which has a protease site sitting in the middle of it. And that's coupled with these ATPases. There are various ATPases that work next to it. And the ATPase is responsible for unfolding proteins, which then get fed into the barrel of the protease and cleave it. This is present in all bacteria and in mitochondria, which are basically bacteria. plays an important role in some physiology, mostly having to do with stress. When the cell is stressed, proteins can become denatured. The denatured proteins can themselves become toxic in various ways, and they can be degraded by CLIP. Many years ago, we did a screen for proteins that were essential, the proteins that were required for bacterial growth. And to our surprise, we found that the CLIP subunits were among those that were essential. I should point out here that it's a little more complicated in mycobacteria, as we've learned. There are two different CLIP Ps, the protease subunits, and you need to have a ring of each one in order to be fully functional. There are a couple of different ATPases. I'm showing you CLIP C1 here, and depleting CLIP C1 or depleting CLIP P results in bacterial death. Why is that? I'll say we don't know. One of our hypotheses, though, is that it's important in turning over proteins that can become toxic. To look at this, we looked at which proteins accumulate when we deplete CLIP. We can't remove it, but we can deplete it. And when we deplete it, we find certain proteins, for example, this one here, YB1, which has a tag on its C-terminus, which targets it to for CLIP degradation. It's a DNA binding protein, or probably more like a chromatin binding protein than a transcription factor. And if we stabilize it by blocking that sequence that's required for degradation, the cells die. So that having too much of this around is clearly toxic. So that's at least one of the mechanisms. But one of the striking things about CLIP is that there are two different ATPases. There's CLIP C, there's CLIP X, missed typo here, should be a single CLIP C or CLIP X. And both CLIP X and CLIP C1 and CLIP P1 and CLIP P2, all of them are essential. So we know that these can be good drug targets because nature has targeted CLIP C1 several times over. So these four unrelated compounds, which are made by soil organisms or marine organisms, are killed mycobacteria, and resistant mutants all have mutations in CLIP C1. They have them nearby each other. It turns out that all these compounds bind nearby each other, and they're all cyclic peptides. We don't totally understand how they work. And recently we've been studying these things and found that they all do something different. And so binding at that site in CLIP C1, near that site, produces allosteric changes in the molecule, and they affect the different enzymatic activities of the protease complex in different ways. So there appears to be more than one way of killing, and that I think is an advantage of CLIP. We know that increasing or decreasing activity or modulating activity in different ways, all of them result in bacterial cell death. And when we've gone on to make with our friends at the TB Alliance, several synthetic cyclic peptides based on these, we find that similarly, they have a tremendous range of biochemical activity. We know that, again, and so CLIP C1 is complicated as a target, and we've just found together with people at Eli Lilly, some small molecules that might affect it that aren't very potent, but might affect CLIP C1. But we thought there was money in CLIP P, in the CLIP protease subunits, because of their resemblance in some ways to the proteasome can be inhibited. It can be inhibited by an actual drug. This compound here, bortezomib. Bortezomib is a peptide, but it's a modified peptide that includes this boronate residue. And the boronate acts as a transition state analog, as a semi-irreversible inactivator of the serine protease in the proteasome. And the mechanism of cleavage in the proteasome is quite similar to the CLIP, which is also a serine protease. So we synthesized a number of peptide boronates based on what we knew about the specificity, and a number of them inhibit, and gratifyingly, a number of them are also kill mycobacteria at low, sort of in the low micromolar range. And we've gone on with the TB Alliance to synthesize a couple hundred analogs of these. This is actually a slightly dated slide, and we have some that have inhibitory concentrations down in the, have KIs down in the nanomolar range and many sub micromolar compounds, killing compounds. But Compounds are not drugs. And that has been driven home to us in a big way, because we have made compounds that are, you know, peptides that are not, that have beautiful properties. They're relatively potent. They are orally absorbable, so they can be given orally, which is something that we want. And they can and they kill mycobacteria. I mean, they have good pharmacology. And what happens when you give them to mice? They very rapidly kill mice, which is great if you're interested in pest control, but not as good for a drug. And so I think we have a very long way to go with developing something like this into a drug. It will take years, which is not very surprising, because if you look at drugs, real drugs that are protease inhibitors, it took a long time for them to come about. HIV was an outbreak analogous in some ways to COVID-19. We hadn't seen it before, and we started developing drugs anew, and it took many, many years to come up with these, despite very concentrated efforts. Similarly, these are Hep C protease inhibitors, and again, it took many years, despite the fact that there was a substantial commercial drive to do it. But proteases are awfully good targets, and that's true for the coronaviruses as well. Both SARS and SARS-CoV-2 share properties with many viruses. Their proteins are translated, most of their proteins are translated as a single large polyprotein, which has to be cleaved into functional units. And the coronaviruses rely on two different proteases, PL-Pro and CL-Pro, each of which cleaves in unique parts of the protein. So all of these cleavages are essential, and so both of these are individually essential. They don't overlap with each other. And so it's been very tempting to think about protease inhibitors for COVID-19. And there were some off-the-shelf and very poor inhibitors that are inhibitors of other proteases like lopinavir, but in this clinical study done early on in China, a very nicely done study, they didn't work, which isn't very surprising, because in vitro they're not very good. Now, I'm going to end with some good news and then followed by some bad news. This is the good news. There are lots of peptidic inhibitors of beta coronaviruses that have been developed. And some of them are quite potent, and most of them will inhibit viral replication. And we recently saw, for example, a structure-guided understanding of one of them, a ketoamide modified peptide, that inhibits the SARS-CoV-2 protease, the CL-Pro protease. So that's the good news. Here's the bad news. That's not a drug. And here's the bad news, which is these sorts of efforts started in the days of SARS-CoV-1. The original paper, which a lot of this is based on, was published in Science back in 2003. And this work was largely abandoned or not worked on in a concentrated manner. And since then, we've had two more outbreaks of coronaviruses. If we're going to make something, if we're going to make therapeutics, we have to spend some time at it. Now, we've already heard about the very impressive rapid progress in vaccines that is made in vaccines with new technologies. And I think that the vaccine folks with technology development have really been able to accelerate our responses to an outbreak. But we don't have that same sort of acceleration on the therapeutic side. So unless we have something off the shelf, we have to spend some time at it. And that means we have to anticipate what's going to happen. The good news is that most of these compounds are broadly active against all coronaviruses, including MERS, including the original SARS. But I think that we need to anticipate more and invest more if we're going to be ready for an outbreak. So proteases are great targets. I think they're good. They're really very good targets in bacteria as well as in viruses. But it takes a long time, and we're going to have to make an investment if we're going to make them. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for this very nice thinking lecture. So I would like to take the first question that I have in front of me, which is, to what extent protease inhibitors may be used for curing SARS-CoV-2, what degree of side effects they might produce on host? So the first part to answer, but the second part, maybe I think it's It would be interesting because probably this has been discussed for HIV or for other protease inhibitor in the past. So,
I mean, I think that, you know, ours is a cautionary tale. The fact that we are able to get really good rodenticides out of compounds that we made to kill mycobacteria is not good, because the protease inhibitors are potent molecules, and there are a lot of host proteases. So it's going to take some empiricism probably to figure out whether or not we're primarily inhibiting the viral protease or inhibiting host proteases. That being said, there are a lot of success stories, so I think it's promising.
So another question is, considering the high homology of coronavirus proteases, is it possible, is it feasible to achieve selective inhibitors?
It is, and I think that for there are inhibitors that are selective for the SARS coronaviruses and don't inhibit the MERS coronavirus protease, for example. Although I'd argue that what we really want is the broader range proteases, with the caveat, again, that you run the risk that you're going to inhibit other host proteases and maybe have deleterious effects.
So are you yourself searching for protease inhibitors for the corona?
So we heard earlier that coronavirus came along and the lab was closed down, so you got to do something. And so we did reopen the lab. We have expressed these proteins. We are making some inhibitors of them right now. I suspect that we're way behind the game, and that's good. I just want someone to succeed, but it is very interesting work for the people in the lab right now.
So when we talk about these inhibitors for proteases involved in corona infection, there are those proteases which are inside the cells, but there are also those which are on the surface and all that. Can you comment on that?
So I think, let me go to bacteria in general. The key to a drug is that it has to inhibit something that's important. And for some bacteria, surface proteases are really important. And they're quite accessible because getting into bacteria isn't as easy as getting into eukaryotic host cells and getting in viral proteins. So I think that in some cases, surface proteases are really going to be the way to go. For viruses, it's a little less important because most things seem to get through the plasma membrane of eukaryotic cells. Some of them are pumped out, but most things seem to get in.
Okay, so I think there is another.
Maybe I ask one?
Oh, okay, go ahead, Nessus.
So Eric, you said at some point that both inhibitors and activators of CLIP protease work really well. And are all in the same bag, or is there any difference? There were earlier studies that were implying also that activators might be able to completely eradicate populations, even non-growing populations.
Yeah, so this is work primarily from staff, where some natural products, the acyldepsipeptides, activate, and they can kill bacteria in any physiologic state. They basically turn the protease into a nonspecific garbage dump and just start degrading everything, as far as we can tell, by changing its conformation. Unfortunately, we haven't found many of those in mycobacteria. There's one compound I'm aware of that's not published that does it, but the acyldepsipeptides in mycobacteria are inhibitors of CLIP. But it would be very desirable, I think, to have an activator. And as I said, I know of one example where people have synthesized something.